Welcome back to Curious Vet, dear friends. I am Dr. Mohsina. Today's topic is a little bit lengthy, but it is an important viral disease in poultry. So the topic for today's video is Marek disease in poultry. So let's begin. Chickens are the most important natural host for Marek's disease virus or MDV. And this virus is a highly cell-associated but readily transmitted alpha herpes virus with lymphocyte lymphotropic properties of gamma herpes virus. Quail can be naturally infected and turkeys can be infected experimentally. However, severe clinical outbreaks of Marek's disease in commercial turkey flocks with mortality from tumors reaching 40-80% between 8 and 17 weeks of age were reported in France, Israel and Germany. In some of these cases, the affected turkey flocks were raised in proximity to broilers, and turkeys are also commonly infected with turkey herpes virus or HVT, an A virulent strain related to Marek disease virus that is commonly used as MDV vaccine in chickens. Other birds and mammals appear to be refractory to the disease or infection. Marek disease is one of the most ubiquitous avian infections. It is identified in chicken flocks worldwide. Every flock, except for those maintained under strict pathogen-free conditions, is presumed to be infected. Although clinical disease is not always apparent in infected flocks, a subclinical disease, subclinical decrease in growth rate and egg production is economically important. Coming to the etiology. Marek disease virus is a member of the genus Mardivirus within the subfamily Alpha Herpes Virinae. Within the genus Mardivirus are three closely related species previously designated as three serotypes of MDV. Let's see one by one. One is the Galid Herpes Virus 2, that is MDV serotype 1. It represents all virulent Marek disease virus strains and is further divided into pathotypes designated as mild, virulent, very virulent and very virulent plus. Next is the Galid Herpes Virus 3, that is MDV serotype 2, and Meleagrid Alpha Herpes Virus 1 or HVT or MDV serotype 3. These two represent A virulent strains isolated from chickens and turkeys respectively and are commonly used as vaccines against Marek disease. Coming to the transmission and epidemiology, Marek disease is highly contagious and is readily transmitted among chickens. The virus matures into a fully infective enveloped form in the epithelium of feather follicle from which it is released into the environment. It may survive for months in poultry house litter or dust. Dust or dander from infected chickens is particularly effective in transmission, and once the virus is introduced into the chicken flock, regardless of the vaccination status, infection spreads quickly from bird to bird. Infected chickens continue to be carriers for long periods and act as sources of infectious virus. Shedding of infectious virus can be reduced but not prevented by prior vaccination. Unlike virulent strain of Marek disease virus, which are highly contagious, turkey herpes virus is not readily transmissible among chickens. Although it is easily transmitted among turkeys, its natural host. Attenuated Marek disease virus strains vary greatly in their transmissibility among chickens. The most highly attenuated are not transmitted, and Marek disease virus is not vertically transmitted. Now let's see the Marek disease virus life cycle here. Bird inhale MDV particles from dust in the environment, and MDV invades lung airspace and infects epithelial cells. The MDV infects cells and spread into the feather follicle to mature and replicate, and the birds shed the MDV particles in skin dander, which again get inhaled by another bird and the bird get infected. Now let's move on to pathogenesis. Currently, four phases of infection with Marek disease in vivo are recognized. One is the early cytolytic infection, latent infection. Then the second phase of cytolytic productive respiratory infection with permanent immunosuppression. And fourth is the proliferative phase, where in non-productively infected lymphoid cells may or may not progress to the point of lymphoma formation. Productive infection may occur transiently in B lymphocytes within few days after infection with MDV virus strains. It is characterized by antigen production leading to cell death. And any virions, if produced, have only few virions are produced. So it is named as restrictive productive infection. And productive infection also occurs in feather follicle epithelium, in which enveloped virions are produced. Then latent infection of activated T cells is responsible for long-term carrier state. Here no antigens are expressed, but virus can be recovered from such lymphocytes. And some T cells latently infected with oncogenic MDV undergo neoplastic transformation, and these transformed cells may escape the immune system of the host and may multiply to form characteristic lymphoid neoplasm. So this virus enters through respiratory tract or skin through dander and dust infection, and first they infected the B cell, then the T cell. And in the second phase, that is latency, latently infected cells will go and multiply in the feather follicle, and some cells get transformed in the transformation state, that is transformed T cells, leading to T lymphoma and tumor formation and death. And out-shedding infectious mature virions or dander shedding out. And coming to the clinical findings, the incidence of Marek's disease is quite variable in commercial flocks and depend on strain and dose of virus, age at exposure, maternal antibody, host gender and genetics, strain and dose of vaccine virus, and several environmental factors including stress. In addition to lymphoid neoplasms, MDV can also induce other clinically distinct disease syndrome, including transient paralysis, early mortality syndrome, cytolytic infection, atherosclerosis, and persistent neurologic damage. In Marek disease, the clinical signs associated with peripheral nerve dysfunction are frequently the most easily noticed one. One leg stretched forward and one leg backward is the typical presentation of leg paresis in chicken with Marek disease, as shown in this picture. You can see one leg is stretched forward and one leg is stretched backward. So this is associated with peripheral nerve dysfunction. Then typically affected birds show only depression before death, but a transient paralysis syndrome has been associated with Marek disease, as we saw in the picture, and chicken become ataxic for periods of several days and then recover. This syndrome is rare in immunized birds, and death is usually the result of paralysis, rendering the birds unable to reach food and water. There is eye involvement with a neoplastic cell infiltration into the iris, resulting in irregular pupil in a chicken with Marek disease. You can see the picture of a chicken with irregular pupil here. This is due to the neoplastic cell infiltration into the iris. So here also you can see ocular lymphomatosis causes lymphocyte infiltration of iris, and here the iris is turning to gray, and unequal size of pupil can be seen, and blindness. So the right eye is here affected with Marek disease, and the left eye is normal eye. Coming to the postmortem lesions, enlarged nerves are one of the most consistent gross lesions in affected birds. Various peripheral nerves, but particularly the vagus, brachial and sciatic, become enlarged and lose their striations. Diffuse or nodular lymphoid tumors may be seen in various organs, particularly liver, spleen, gonads, heart, lung, kidney, muscle and proventriculus. In these pictures you can see nodular lymphoid tumors in liver here. Here you can see the unilateral enlargement of sciatic nerve and sacral plexus in chicken with Marek disease. Enlarged feather follicles, commonly termed as skin leucosis, may be noticed in broilers after defeathering during processing and are a cause of condemnation. Bursa is only rarely tumorous and are more frequently atrophic. Nodular tumors in the skin are common cause of condemnation of broiler chicken with Marek disease, and broiler chickens can also have erythematous lesions of the shank. Here you can see erythematous lesion of the shank, commonly referred as Alabama red leg. Coming to the histopathology, histologically the lesions consist of a mixed population of small, medium and large lymphoid cells, plasma cells and large anaplastic lymphoblast. These cell populations undoubtedly include tumor cells and reactive inflammatory cells. When the bursa is involved, the tumor cells typically appear in interfollicular areas. This picture you can see symmetrical neoplastic foci of pleomorphic cells in the liver of a chicken infected with Marek disease virus. This is stained with HND stain. And here you can see diffuse pleomorphic cell proliferation in the myocardium, resulting in atrophy of myofibrils caused by MDV virus infection. And in the diagnosis, there are two criteria to be followed. One is the standard criteria, which involves history and clinical signs, gross pathology and histopathology. And there is one advanced criteria, which involves immunohistochemistry, standard and quantitative PCR, virus isolation and serology. For the diagnosis of Marek disease, it is critical to diagnose the tumors and not the infection, because Marek disease is considered ubiquitous within the commercial poultry flock. So it is important to diagnose the tumors. Usually diagnosis is based on enlarged nerves and lymphoid tumors in various viscera. The absence of bursal tumors helps distinguish this disease from lymphoid leukosis, although the presence of bursal tumor does not exclude Marek disease. So in lymphoid leukosis there is bursal tumors, but usually in Marek disease bursal tumors are absent and there is bursal atrophy. Marek disease can develop in chickens as young as 3 weeks old, whereas lymphoid leukosis typically seen in chicken more than 14 weeks old. So these are the two main differences between lymphoid leukosis and Marek disease. One is bursal tumor and other is the age of chicken infected. Then reticular endotheliosis, although rare, can easily be confused with MDV because both diseases can feature enlarged nerves and T-cell lymphomas in visceral organs. Standard criteria are often sufficient for a presumptive diagnosis, but advanced criteria are needed for a definitive diagnosis. Immunohistochemistry can be used to confirm tumors are composed of T cell population or expressing specific MDV antigen. So immunohistochemistry is an important step in the advanced criteria of definitive diagnosis. There is a quantitative association between viral load and Marek's disease tumors. Most tumor-bearing chickens have high viremia titers and are usually PCR positive. Thus, the demonstration of high quantities of virus, viral DNA or viral antigen in tumor cells and exclusion of other relevant tumor viruses should be sufficient for specific diagnosis of Marek's disease. Coming to the control measures. Actually, there is no effective treatment for Marek disease, and prevention methods include vaccination, biosecurity, and genetic resistance. Vaccination is the central strategy for the prevention and control of Marek disease. Along with strict sanitation to reduce or delay exposure and by breeding for genetic resistance. The most widely used vaccines are, first one is the turkey herpes virus, which is a very important one, HVT, that is naturally virulent meleagrid alpha herpes virus 1. Then SB1 or 301B bar 1, that is also Gallet alpha herpes virus 3. Then CV1988 or RISPENS, attenuated Gallet alpha herpes virus 2. HVT vaccine has been rapidly increased use as a backbone in recommended vaccines featuring the insertion of genes from other poultry viruses such as Newcastle disease virus, infectious bursal disease virus or infectious laryngotracheitis virus. So there is recombinant vaccine between HVT and these diseases. And these recombinant vaccines offer protection against both MDV and the inserted virus. Bivalent vaccines consisting of HVT and either the SB1 or 301B bar 1 strain of Gallet alpha herpes virus 3 has been used to provide additional protection against challenge with virulent Marek disease virus isolate, and the most protective commercial vaccine currently available appears to be CV1988 bar RISPENS, an attenuated MDV virus strain commonly mixed with HVT at vaccination. Vaccines are administered at hatch or in vivo to embryos at the 18th day of incubation. In vivo vaccination is now performed by automated technology and is widely used for vaccination of commercial broiler chickens mainly because of reduced labor cost and greater precision of vaccine administration. Proper handling of vaccine during thawing and reconstitution is crucial to ensure that adequate doses are administered. Cell-associated vaccines are generally more effective than cell-free vaccines because they are neutralized less by maternal antibodies. Under typical conditions, vaccine efficacy is usually more than 90%. Since the advent of vaccination, losses from the Marek disease have been reduced dramatically in broiler and layer flocks. However, disease may become a serious problem in individual flocks or in selected geographic areas. Of the many causes proposed for these excessive losses, early exposure to very virulent virus strains appear to be among the most important. Now, let's go through the key points once again. That is, Marek disease is a highly contagious neoplastic disease characterized by T cell lymphomas and peripheral nerve enlargement. Leg paralysis is a common clinical sign, and presumptive diagnosis can be made based on history, clinical signs, growth pathology and histopathology. Vaccines are highly protective and should be used in combination with good biosecurity. So that's all about Marek disease virus. So it is a little bit lengthy topic, but it is very important topic. So go through all the different aspects of this disease. And if the video is informative, please like it and share it with your friends and comment your suggestions. If you are new to this channel and not subscribed yet, please subscribe and click the notification bell so that you get notified every time I upload a video. See you soon with another video. Thank you.